you begin, approach the podium.
Good morning. May it please the court, my name is Ida Haratunian, counsel for Appellant Ali Bararsani. I would like to reserve 3 minutes for rebuttal.
Can you speak up? You're very soft.
Yes, sorry. Good morning, and may it please the court. My name is Ida Haratunian, counsel for Appellant Ali Bararsani. I would like to reserve 3 minutes for rebuttal, please.
All right, please watch the clock.
On the surface, this case may seem like a routine insurance dispute. When we dig a little deeper, this case actually presents the unique opportunity for this court to hold that an insured may use discovery requests in triggering the duty to defend. California is known for having unique state laws that extend broad protection to the public, and the insurance context is no different. California law makes it clear that an insurer's duty to defend is triggered once the insured shows the mere possibility of coverage. And that was all Mr. Bararsani had to do below, and indeed, what he in fact accomplished.
Counsel?
Yes.
Should we look to Mr. Bararsani's declaration, which was attached to his opposition to his summary judgment motion, or to the summary judgment motion filed by the other side, as evidence that his alleged wrongful conduct might have occurred during the policy period? The declaration, which is in the record, paragraph 5 talks about his representation of Mr. Rubenstein through April 25th, 2018. And I'm curious to know whether or not you think that that declaration is evidence of his potential activity within the policy period.
I would say yes, it could be, but there's actually more and better evidence. I would point to court to the RFAs, which can be found on ER 19. And Rubenstein essentially served a series of requests for admission, which asked Mr. Bararsani to admit various things related to March 21st, 2018, which falls clearly within the covered period. Rubenstein asks Mr. Bararsani to admit that he asked Rubenstein not to cancel escrow on March 21st, 2018. He asks Bararsani to admit that he verbally assured Rubenstein that he would receive the full return of his escrow deposit.
Can you tell me what cause of action? If we're only looking at activities that Bararsani engaged in, I guess it's after March 14th, 2018, what cause of action arises from the actions limited to what he did after that date?
There are two causes of action, fraud and breach of fiduciary duty. For the fraud claim, I would like to point out that Mr. Rubenstein asks for three different types of damages. He asks for a $60,000 release, and he also asks for foregone rent that he was supposed to charge his business partners but chose not to, and improvements to the Dearborn property that he undertook. His underlying complaint, however, makes no mention of when he chose to undergo these improvements.
So the Dearborn property, he knew that was out well before March 14th, because his partner said the Dearborn deal is off. The $60,000 went hard well before March 14th also. So after March 14th, are you saying there are foregone rents, and is that the harm that he took? And how does that relate? Because he, at that point, all he had was the chance of getting the money back if the escrow closed. I guess I'm trying to figure out what his loss was after March 14th.
Well, again, if we look at the RFAs, Rubenstein still asks Bararsani to admit a series of actions on March 21st.
Right, and they go to a state of mind and the like, but they don't have anything to do with harm to Rubenstein. That's what I'm trying to figure out.
I actually believe that they do, because even if these RFAs, for example, may seem a bit, let's say, contradictory to the allegations in the complaint, the duty to defend is triggered even for groundless or fraudulent
allegations as well. What's the harm to Rubenstein? That's what I'm trying to understand. What harm that he could claim in a cause of action against Bararsani?
Well, he alleges that he relied on Mr. Bararsani's misrepresentations and, again, foregoing rent. So we also have no idea.
What rent did he forego? I'm not understanding that.
So Mr. Rubenstein had intended to charge his business partner's rent on both the Dearborn and the Norton property, the Linwood property, I believe, and he chose to forego charging them rent.
But that was all gone by that time. I'm sorry.
But I mean, is harm the policy covers wrongful acts. If I commit a wrongful act in January and it harms you for 10 years, the later isn't what counts. It's the wrongful act that counts, isn't it?
It is the wrongful act, but the complaint does not actually tell us when Mr. Bararsani committed these.
I understand you say that things were indefinite, although the complaint doesn't say, doesn't affirmatively say at any times. It just stops. But let me put it this way. After March 14th, how could something that was said have made him worse off than he was before? As I understand it, he put the $60,000 in issue back in January. And the partners' activities, when they pulled the plug on him, that already happened. So what could have made him worse off? What could Bararsani have said to Rubenstein that would have made him worse off after March 14th?
Well, Mr. Rubenstein also brings a claim for breach of fiduciary duty. And if we look at RFA number 88 on ER 20, it asks, admit that you breached your fiduciary duty to Rubenstein on March 21st, 2018, when you asked Rubenstein not to cancel escrow for the purchase of the Linwood.
Okay, so you're going back to these requests for admissions. Does that indicate that without the requests for admissions, you wouldn't have much?
No, not necessarily, because as I mentioned,
when I read the complaint, I'm looking for something that would have made Rubenstein worse off, and that's where I'm having trouble. Can you clarify that for me?
Yes, of course.
Because and correct me on this, this promissory note, whatever happened to that? Did he not collect on it or something?
Yes, Mr. Rubenstein contends that he was never given the funds from the promissory note.
I'm sorry, he was never given the promissory?
Yes, he never collected.
Never collected or never given it?
He was never paid back by the co-defendants.
And is that a separate cause of action in this suit?
It is not a separate cause of action, but Mr. Rubenstein's fraud and breach of fiduciary duty claims could very well relate to that incident, in the sense that perhaps one of the alleged misrepresentations that Mr. Bararsani made that breached his fiduciary duty had to do with telling Mr. Rubenstein that he would receive his full funds.
But at
and
the
that he
time
would be paid
of
back.
The time he was given the promissory note, the $60,000 was already hard. And he got the rest of the money back when the escrow failed. He got the $109,000. So the $60,000 was already lost to him before March 14th. So it didn't seem like the promissory note had much effect one way or the other. Why does that, as Judge Boggs says, make him worse off?
Well, because the promissory note would have repaid him back that $60,000. The promissory note was for $1,609.
Right, but it didn't make him worse off. It just didn't make him better off.
But it did, because he essentially ended up losing that $60,000 that he would have had the defendants paid back the promissory note.
But and Bararsani kept them from, that's what I don't understand, why you didn't collect on the promissory note. If it's a good note, you just sue and get that money.
To be honest, Your Honor, I'm not sure, and the underlying action was settled, so.
I'm sorry, you're not sure?
Sorry, I have no idea why Mr. Rubenstein failed to collect on the promissory note.
All right, there's nothing other than the broad allegation of fiduciary duty that says that Bararsani had anything to do with that.
It could be ground in the fraud claims as well.
Okay. Now, and the promissory note was signed on March 21, which is 7 days into the coverage period. Am I right about that?
Yes,
so
you are
at
correct.
At least in a speculative way, you could say maybe Bararsani said something in those 7 days that led him to accept it.
But what then, if he accepted it, what difference did that make to his situation? He got an additional promise of getting the money paid back, which ended up, for whatever reason, we don't know, he didn't, we take. But he had already lost the $60,000.
It could perhaps influence his decision to forego rent still. He could have maybe made other measures or other actions to attempt to reclaim that $60,000.
Did you want to save the rest of your time for rebuttal?
I actually have about a minute left.
Okay.
I'd like to continue.
So why don't you help us understand what rents he was expecting? Who was renting what from him?
So his co-defendants had agreed to pay rent for the Dearborn property.
Right, but he was out of the Dearborn property pretty early on, right?
Well, it seems
so
like...
So he had a venture, and then they said, you're out, we're replacing you. So that was in January 2018, right? So he couldn't have had any expectation of rent after that point.
Yes, that's true. It also seems as if sorry, give me one moment. He still could have made improvements and expenditures to the Dearborn property that I believe could have been undertaken within the coverage period. I will now conclude because I have my 3 minutes. Thank you.
All right. We'll hear from the other side.
Good morning, Your Honors. Once again, my name is Gary Lehendro. I represent HDI Global Insurance. Mr. Bararsani is arguing that the fraud cause of action, the breach of fiduciary duty cause of actions, do not provide us with the date that the alleged wrongful misrepresentations occurred. However, the complaint does provide us with that information. Fortunately, the complaint tells us what Mr. Rubenstein did in response to Mr. Bararsani's alleged misrepresentations. And it also tells us when those actions by Mr. Rubenstein occurred. For instance, with respect to the fraud cause of action, in response to Mr. Bararsani's alleged misrepresentations, he decided and agreed to purchase the Linwood property, and he also deposited in escrow the invested principal of $169,500. The complaint tells us that occurred in October of 2017. That predates the retroactive date of the policy of March 14, 2018. That also tells us Mr. Bararsani must have made the misrepresentations on or before October 2017. Therefore, that misrepresentation that pertains to the fraud cause of action necessarily the wrongful act necessarily occurred before the coverage period of the HDI policy.
Well, the other side argues that after the $60,000 went hard, but the Bararsani, along with the other individuals, urged Rubenstein to keep the money in escrow after the promissory note and all that, which happened after March 14th. Does that give rise to a coverable event?
Mr. Bararsani is speculating as to allegations that could be could exist. In other words, he could have made representations after March 14, 2018, but there are no such allegations in the complaint.
Right, but if the complaint can be changed to allege them, that's enough to trigger coverage, right?
No, Your Honor. Under California law, under the Gunderson case, a person seeking coverage under an insurance policy cannot speculate as to what the third-party plaintiff may later amend or may be alleging. The two wrongful acts here that pertain to Mr. Bararsani for each cause of action both occurred prior to the retroactive date. The first one was depositing the money in escrow and agreeing to buy the Linwood property, which occurred in October 2017. The second one, which is tied to the breach of fiduciary cause of action, is Mr. Rubenstein agreeing to amend the escrow instructions and withdraw the $60,000 or to give the $60,000 to the buyer, or I'm sorry, the seller, Norton, to extend the contingency dates for escrow. That occurred on January 23rd, 2018. That is also prior to the retroactive date of the policy. Therefore, there's no potential for coverage for each one of those wrongful acts alleged in the complaint against Mr. Bararsani.
Do you agree that Bararsani was still involved with Rubenstein after the retroactive date, March 14th?
Yes.
Okay, because there are at least two documents that seem to indicate in March and early April that he was either attempting to contact Rubenstein. Okay.
Yes, Your Honor.
So basically you're saying that it is either impossible or only speculative that he could have done anything during that later time period that would have been a wrongful act. Because isn't that the key, that whether a wrongful act occurred?
You're correct, Your Honor. Under the policy, from a coverage standpoint, it's the timing of the wrongful act, not the timing of any damages that may have occurred as a result of that wrongful act. So there are no allegations whatsoever, as Judge Anderson also found, after January 23rd, 2018, of wrongful acts involving Mr. Bararsani.
Why is it that the declaration of Mr. Bararsani that indicates that he represented Mr. Rubenstein in the Linwood property purchase through April of 2018 not provide the potential for coverage, which, as I understand it, and correct me if I'm wrong, under California law, sets forth a very broad duty to defend if there is any conduct that may fall within the policy period. So we have a representation through April of 2018, which is beyond the retroactive date for coverage. That representation includes and relates to exactly the property that the escrow amendment was made for. And then there are allegations in the complaint relating to Mr. Rubenstein's decision-making around that escrow and amendment that is past the March 2018 date. So I'm trying to understand why even the possibility of that representation through April doesn't meet the very low standard under California law for a duty to defend.
Thank you, Your Honor. The evidence in this case reveals that Mr. Bararsani, with respect to the Rubenstein transaction, was working under the brokerage license of Cal Mutual. Now, Cal Mutual isn't the named insured under the HDI policy. That's California and the States, Inc. To be specific, first of all, if we look at the California Department of Real Estate license history for Mr. Bararsani, it reveals that he was under the brokerage of Cal Mutual, not the insured, from November of 2017 all the way through September 4th of 2018. Okay. Also, part of the evidence in the record was Mr. Bararsani's answer to the to Mr. Rubenstein's complaint, and in it is his 12th affirmative defense, misjoinder of parties, wherein he states, basically, as to all events alleged in the complaint, I was working for Cal Mutual, not the insured.
You're talking about something completely different than my question. You're talking about whether or not this particular policy covered Mr. Bararsani, and you might want to make arguments about that separately. But my question really relates to, under the standard that California law provides us, which is a low bar for triggering the duty to defend, why is the representation that we that you agree the declaration states, and you're not controverting the fact that Mr. Bararsani represented Mr. Rubenstein through April of 2018 relating to the Linwood property purchase, which is exactly what's at issue in the underlying complaint. Why doesn't that fact at least allow Mr. Bararsani to survive summary judgment under California law?
Because there are no wrongful acts tied to that declaration. In other words, if proven true.
But there's a breach of fiduciary duty claim that generally alleges that there was that representation as between Mr. Bararsani and Mr. Rubenstein caused a breach of fiduciary duty.
Yes, Your Honor, there is an allegation of that. However, when we look at the complaint, once again, what Mr. Rubenstein did in response to the alleged misrepresentation by Mr. Bararsani, what he did in response to that was he amended escrow instruction to instruct escrow to release $60,000 to Norton, the seller of the property. Now, that occurred in January 28th of 2018. That predates March 14th, 2018, and it predates the coverage period of the policy. So
I guess if Mr. Bararsani was continuing to lie, to make fraudulent statements to Mr. Rubenstein after that date until April 25th. Are lies themselves and misrepresentations themselves enough to trigger the property?
Well, there are no allegations in the complaint that, as Judge Anderson found, there are no allegations of wrongful conduct by Mr. Bararsani after January 23rd, 2018. Mm-hmm. He may have continued to represent Mr. Rubenstein in the Rubenstein transaction, but that's all that would prove, is that he continued to represent him during that time period. There are no wrongful acts alleged after January 23rd, 2018.
Now, let me ask you a perhaps side question. This policy was issued in 2020.
Yes.
All of these activities which create these, you know, close dates in March and April were 2 years earlier. Is there any indication about why the policy was issued at that time from your side, or why they sought it at that time from their side, with exactly a 2-year retroactivity period that drops right in the middle of all this?
It's a claims-made policy, Your Honor. So, if a claim is made within the coverage period, within the policy period.
Yeah, but the length of the retroactivity is up to the negotiation of the parties, right?
Yes, the retroactive date, yeah. I would assume it is, yes.
Okay, I mean, maybe there's no good answer to it. Things happen as they happen.
Right.
If the complaint had just said Bararsani made representations throughout his period of representing me that caused me loss, would that be good enough to at least trigger the duty to defend?
I'm sorry, can you repeat that? Just
I said, if the complaint said, throughout the period of his representation of me, Rubenstein, he made misrepresentations that caused me loss.
Yeah, I think that would.
Okay.
Would. But
so really the issue here is how do we get from what's in the complaint to an implication that is more like what I just said? Is that speculative, inventive, or fanciful, or is it a mere possibility that's enough?
Well, in your example, you would be alleging wrongful acts during the entire Rubenstein transaction.
Even though in my example I gave no dates.
Right. However, here, as I indicated, the complaint does tell us the dates by which...
It's just bad drafting on the complaint that that hurts him?
Depending on which side you're on, Your Honor.
Let me ask you a question. I want to ask you a question about your comment just now that the complaint doesn't allege a specific date. But I'm looking at the complaint. I'm looking at paragraphs 25 and 26. And there was clearly, and maybe you can help me understand, something happened that caused Mr. Rubenstein to not close the escrow. In fact, he held off, and the complaint alleges that he was put in a difficult position, faced with this difficult situation. He decided to hold off on canceling the escrow to give the original partners the opportunity to close escrow. And in fact, he waited, I think arguably he waited because he was given advice to wait. He was induced to wait. He was told if he waited, perhaps they'll close escrow. I'm not sure. And then ultimately on April 25th, 2018, Norton requested that the escrow be closed and sent instructions for that to occur. So what happened? What happened that caused Rubenstein to decide to hold off on canceling the escrow? You know, the complaint just generally talks about this but doesn't allege any allegations other than, you know, between March 21st, 2018 and April 25th. But something happened because he waited to cancel the escrow.
Right. But what the complaint doesn't say is that Mr. Rubenstein did so in reliance upon any alleged misrepresentation or wrongful act by Mr. Bararsani.
Is it possible that he did?
It may be possible, but once again, under California law, I don't want to conflate a potential for coverage with a possibility that events may have occurred. They're not in the complaint. In California law, the standard in California law is that a person seeking coverage under a policy cannot speculate as to what a plaintiff may allege later or what, you know, they meant to allege but failed to allege. If that were the case, an insurance company would always have a duty to defend, and I'd shudder to think what everyone's premiums would be at that point.
Counsel, focusing on paragraph 25, as Judge Desai indicated, how was Rubenstein, or was Rubenstein worse off by holding off as opposed to presumably canceling escrow immediately at the first time he could have?
I don't know.
Perhaps your adversary can answer that question. Okay.
And once again, Your Honor, the focus is on the timing of the wrongful act, not when the damage has occurred.
Okay. I think we have your argument. You're over time.
Thank you.
And you have a few minutes for rebuttal.
If I can press that question, if we sort of assume that Bararsani said something that made Rubenstein hold off, how was Rubenstein any worse off on the later time when escrow was canceled than if it had been canceled at the time of the promissory note, let's say?
Well, Your Honor, I think Rubenstein maybe could have sought to mitigate his damages in some other way at the time, but that is the only thing that I could think that he could have done at the time.
Thank you.
Of course. I would like to first address HDI's argument that Gunderson applies. Gunderson was a completely different case than the one here. In Gunderson, the insured did not present the extrinsic evidence to the insurer, and it was in that context that the court found that they cannot speculate as to coverage. This case is actually a lot more like Horace Mann Insurance versus Barbara B., where the court explicitly held that in the absence of a defined chronology, it cannot be held that there is no possibility that the wrongful acts were tied to covered events. I would also like to quickly discuss the question of foregone rent. Although it's true that the underlying complaint does state that they that Mr. Bararsani's co-defendants were trying to replace Mr. Rubenstein in the Dearborn venture. They still intended to use the Dearborn property, and Rubenstein owned the Dearborn property. So it's very possible that it still could have been likely that there was discussions around rent and other aspects of using the Dearborn property for the Dearborn venture. I realize that speculation and possibility is a bit of a difficult line to toe, and it can be a bit blurry. But Mr. Bararsani only argues that in the absence of any definition, it is possible and reasonable to read the complaint as he did, that some alleged wrongful act fell within the covered period. And if there is any doubt to that when the complaint is read, the request for admission confirmed that Mr. Barasani's reading is a reasonable one. Mr. Bararsani does not ask this court to speculate, but just to acknowledge the possibility in the absence of any defined chronology. That's all. Thank you.
We thank both sides for their argument. The case of Bararsani versus HDI Global Insurance is submitted, and we'll next hear.